Tune into this week's episode of the DevOps Lab, where we're kicking off a series with the Xbox Customer Experiences Team. We're going to talk about how they've adopted DevOps practices, Azure DevOps Bicep, and Azure. So tune in because you don't want to miss this series. On this week's episode of the DevOps Lab, we're kicking off a brand new series with the Xbox Customer Experience Team. So let's welcome Chad and Kate. Welcome both to the DevOps Lab.
Hi, thanks, April. A quick intro for me. My name is Chad Stewart. I am a software developer on the Customer Experiences Team at Xbox. I've been at Microsoft's and on the same team, you know, shifted around a bit, but for 8 years. I have primarily worked on the Xbox Insider program. So if you've ever flown or done a pre-release or a system update, that's part of the services that I've worked on. And I also own the Xbox feedback services. So any bug diagnostics or feedback reporting, all of that stuff is primarily what I've worked on.
Yep, awesome. And Kate, tell us what you do for the Xbox Customer Experience Team.
Oh, thanks, April. My name is Kate Ansolis, and I'm also a software developer as a part of the Orange crew in CXT. And our team primarily focuses on the data processing and reporting. Our team owns a lot of Power BI dashboards with the customer data, with all the fancy graphs and visualizations for the stakeholders, as well as our team develops AI-based models based on the gamer feedback. I worked in Microsoft for over 7 years and primarily worked on the Xbox content moderation team and Xbox family services. Now my major focus is customer support and gamer feedback data processing, as well as auto-suggest feature in Xbox support.com website and social sentiment model and model development and deployment.
Awesome. Now, both of you have been on the Xbox team pretty good amount of time. You've seen the evolution of Xbox. Tell us about some of the pain points you had as a team and how you resolved them.
Sure. So I can speak to some of the pain points that, so our organization is broken into three core crews. We've got a blue, green, orange crew, each kind of have separate responsibilities. For the blue and green crew, showing here on screen now. The customer experience team as a whole is largely representative. It's just a part of Xbox. And we're kind of the voice of the customer. So our services are corely around customer experiences and scenarios. So like subscriptions, managing your doing refunds or order history, things of that nature as shown on screen. We've broken our organization up and we kind of have crews that are responsible for different parts. So we used to have a lot of services in Autopilot, kind of this, it was a homegrown cloud kind of service where basically you can think of it as like a walled garden where we had a bunch of the Xbox services, Xbox Live, things of that nature, all kind of siloed in their own environments, you know, kind of hosted away from the rest of the internet with appropriate access points and stuff. That platform that we used had a lot of problems in that it was very clunky, kind of hard to use. It was a separate system from our actual, like where actual code lived. We had to do separate check-ins to get the deployment started. And it required a lot of maintenance from the engineers who were kind of monitoring those things. Since then, we've kind of moved a lot of our stuff into Azure, basically. Azure is kind of the future of what we're doing in Xbox. All of our new stuff is built in Azure. And we are kind of slowly going through our tech debt log of porting everything that still exists in Autopilot into Azure today.
Cool.
I think Kate can probably speak to some of the kind of the DevOps that Orange has done specifically.
Yeah, thanks, Chad. Yeah, we actually have the same story. We, as our team focuses more on data, we own a lot of Azure data factories for data processing. And for each of those, we create our own CI/CD pipeline. And our organization and make it as a one template was a priority for our team. So before we also had CI/CD ADO pipelines, just very simple ones. Some of the Azure resources we were developing and deploying manually, which was not great. So for us, was trying to find a technology that would be very easy and easy to adopt and to learn fast. And that's where we switched to bicep templates and modules because it was so easy to create and make it as a standard for our team.
Awesome. So it sounds like you guys saw the pain points, pivoted, and were able to successfully deliver with the new tools, and it looks like scale up the team as well and be pretty successful with it.
So here kind of shows the progression of our team as a whole, kind of as we've moved through the past probably 5 years of time. You know, we still have a lot of services that exist in Autopilot, which is kind of this older platform. Like I said before, we're working on moving a lot of that stuff to Azure. And for a long time, like the last three-ish years, we were doing a lot of manual setup in Azure because we hadn't really discovered ARM. Bicep didn't exist at the time. So most of the time, any of our developers were kind of creating these services. We were, you know, manually creating them through the Azure portal, typing in, like copy-pasting connection strings from one place to another, and they were kind of like lived in that environment. It's not the best for maintainability, and it really became a problem when we started to do scaling, like when we were trying to become more elastic with our services, or we wanted to have better testing scenarios, or we wanted to have different environments, just like, you know, pre-production, post-production, integration environments, things of that nature. When we were doing all this manual setup in Azure, granted, it was great because we had these net new services in Azure that were all much kind of lighter weight services than our Autopilot stuff. It just became a little bit of a nightmare when it came to like the scale of the services that we were dealing with. In our most recent time, kind of as Kate alluded to earlier, we basically have kind of ported a lot of our stuff to ARM for a time, and now mostly Bicep. Pretty much all of our Azure services are deployed first with Bicep because it really guarantees that your Azure resources are set up the way that you want. Plus, we found that, you know, Bicep has a very low barrier to entry in terms of someone, especially people like, you know, we have a lot of junior engineers on the team, people who are not necessarily familiar with Azure or Azure resources, how things connect like that. We found that Bicep, the syntax specifically, especially compared to ARM, is much more consumable. It's just something that, you know, anybody on the team can pick up relatively easily and, like, you know, start deploying a service. And also, as Kate said earlier, now Bicep also in ARM allows to have really nice CI/CD pipelines where, you know, we'll run our Bicep first and then our rest of our service will deploy all through like an ADO pipeline.
That's awesome. And that's great to hear because Bicep, one of the key features of it has been readability, ability to consume it and repeat it, et cetera. So awesome. Glad to see you guys have taken that problem, revamped it, went away from that manual process and went to a fully automated CI/CD pipeline.
So I can talk quickly to kind of what the modern tech stack looks like for us. As I mentioned earlier, we have a lot of services that are still in Autopilot, which is kind of like our legacy framework. We don't build anything in Autopilot anymore. It's not necessarily deprecated, but it is not something we're building more in. So today the kind of stance is Azure everything. Build everything in Azure. Basically everything that we need in terms of like a type of service, there's pretty much like an Azure offering that exists for it. And so kind of what's shown here on this table is actually kind of like the breakdown of like, if we have a problem, what the Azure technology is we try to use to solve it. And then kind of an example of one of the services we own that does it. So kind of at the top here, you know, we can see like, if we need to build a web service, typically we build like a regional app with an Azure front door and then some Windows firewall policies on it. If we have like a worker service, we'll use Azure functions with like Service Bus and Event Hub. And then like storage is kind of common across all services, right? We'll have like SQL, Cosmos, Azure Storage, Azure Data Explorer. It really depends on what the service is, but it'll use some kind of storage mechanism. And Kate can talk about some of the specifics around kind of what the Orange Crew does and reporting and stuff.
Sure. So for reporting, we use Power BI dashboards, and majority it's used for visualization for different projects for our stakeholders and customers and also team partners. For monitoring and alerting, we use Application Insights and Azure Monitor, which helps us with our on-call duties and lifecycle troubleshooting. For data processing, we use Azure Data Factory along with the different Azure storage solutions. And for AI ML deployments, majority of times we use Azure ML Workspace, which is Microsoft offering for model development. And for deployment, we use Kubernetes.
Awesome. So it sounds like you guys have done really great job in using the planning tools with Azure DevOps. You're deploying and writing your code in Bicep and in .NET Core, moving that in through your pipelines, deploying to Azure to the various services. And it sounds like you guys have that visibility across all the services, across all the projects really well, and you've actually been able to gain more insight into your products that you're delivering to customers.
Yes, exactly. The Azure DevOps, the kind of like end-to-end we've got here is very streamlined at this point. Historically, we've had a lot of issues where, our lifesite engineer, given any deployment, is going to spend anywhere between an hour or 2 hours kind of monitoring it, just babysitting, making sure everything remains healthy and stuff. We've finally gotten to a point where, because we've kind of got an Azure solution for everything and we're using Azure DevOps to do these deployments so rigorously, we've got everything broken down into stages, and we do testing at various points. So it's gone from being something that used to be kind of like a nightmare for whoever the on-call engineer is to do these deployments to something that they can kind of like fire and forget. You've checked in your code, you click a button, and then all of a sudden it's out to prod.
That's awesome. Well, thank you, Kate. Thank you, Chad, for joining us today and telling us how you guys have made your transformation on the Xbox customer services team. For everyone watching, you can tune in next time, and we're going to show you how the Xbox customer services experience team deploys using Azure DevOps. So tune in.